that the charter provision prevails. And it is where we look to as an initial matter on anything affecting the city. In addition, however, there are certain matters which are either one, not addressed in the charter, or two, are not addressed in the charter with specificity. And to the extent that that is correct, then the city relies upon those things that are covered in Virginia State Code. Unlike, I should add, counties. The counties in Virginia do not have charters at all. They immediately go and look to the Virginia State Code. So for cities, our job is that much more complicated because we almost that are public are not directly covered in our charter that we would therefore rely upon and refer to the Virginia State Code. And in those cases, there are some things in the code that are mandatory for us, then there are others that are simply instructive. And those of us in local government, particularly in cities, wish that the Virginia Supreme Court was much more clear on exactly when those are. They're not, however. So it's the long and short of it is that it's primarily the charter, that the state code does apply in some respects, and that is it's an act of tradition, it's an act of statutory construction. I can figure out exactly what applies.
I raised the question.
That in that particular instance, matter that you just referred to, that the Virginia State Code provides that BZA generally is not a part of two such appeal proceedings. And if I can add that, in our view, that really is consistent with the evolving nature of the law in this entire area of Virginia local government practice. As you know, the case that we cited in the memorandum, the Board of Zoning Appeals, Fairfax County Board of Zoning Appeals case of 2008, that first of all began to clarify the exact nature of BZAs generally, that is, are they, what type of entity are they generally? And that was, I can go into a whole lot more detail about it, but that was sort of one of the first shots in which the state law generally began to wrestle with this whole issue of what is a BZA and how should they be treated. That was, although the 2008 case clarified a number of things, the provision, Mr. Goodell, that you just referred to, 15.2, as you know, was passed in 2010, 2 years after that decision, and we see that as being a further clarification of the Fairfax County case. So, and we again believe that it applies to BZAs generally, both in counties as well as in cities.
I just continue this dialogue. And I, the way you did it the first time, on purpose, or did you file it? Was it a? I guess I'm wondering why we didn't file it as it's amended in the first place.
Mr. Allen, that's a very good question. And first of all, I guess the way I would tell you that no, it was not filed that way intentionally to make it appear adversarial. And honestly, on our side of it, because it was always clear to us that the BZA was not truly a party for any number of reasons that I'm sure we will cover here in over the next few minutes. And honestly, we believe, I will tell you that on behalf of myself, my office, my outside counsel, we were all surprised with the reaction that it got. And frankly, when we got that reaction, we realized that we probably missed something. And that's when we went back and looked at it more closely. And we thought that we should restyle it to properly reflect what we were, number one, trying to do, and more accurately what we believe that the law indicates should be done and required of us to do. Why did we do that in the first place? Because this is, I will tell you this right now before I even say it. I hate when people give me this answer. So I will tell you, I hate giving this answer. But we did it because that's the way it always been done. And I grant you that it is for a reason. But that's what we had done. Our our colleagues in counties have frankly been paying much closer attention to those issues than those of us in cities. And so they have been sensitized to this, that issue much more closely than we had. Frankly, after we began to consult with our colleagues in counties, particularly our two neighboring counties, we realized that we should be paying much more close attention to that. And so we did, and that's why we changed it. So we believe that what's filed now is appropriate under the law and probably should have been the way that all such appeals have been styled, not only in counties, but in cities, at least since 2010. At least since 2010. And I think, frankly, a good argument could have been made that all such cases should have properly been styled that fashion since 2008.
I was just curious.
Oh, sorry.
No, go ahead. I just wondered if you had thought about that before you filed.
Mr. Allen, this whole area of the law, when it comes to how do you handle appeals of the BZA, and frankly, what is the role of the BZA, and are there more than one party on the city side of the ledger or not? It's frankly more complicated than any of us would like for it to be. Those of us in local government law, as well as in other practices that hit upon it, have wrestled with this whole issue for a long time. The bottom line is that on the city side of the ledger, there is but one client, and that is the city. And the city, as a court, because it is a Virginia municipal corporation, and it is a legally recognized entity. And so under the law, it is that entity that represents the city. And so in that sense, the city really is never suing itself, because all of its functions, all of its departments, all of its boards, all of its commissions are part of the city. Then of course, it very quickly devolved into questions of what happens when one commission takes a slightly different view from another commission, from city council, and so you get into that whole issue of who speaks. What voice speaks for the city? And it can be a fairly complicated analysis. But at the end of the day, the city is, the voice of the city is expressed through the elected representatives, that is the city council. They are the one official legally recognized voice for the city. So that their voice then flows through the city manager, his senior staff, and the city attorney.
But wouldn't you agree that the city council would not mean one of the parties that could
be filed? No. Yeah, I would say in our charter provision,
maybe it falls under corporate.
It's in the office of the department board or agency of the city.
Right.
And right. The so any officer of the department board or agency.
So maybe that's why you put Farrell Hanger in as a part. Because
well,
she's the officer.
Well, because no. She is the department head.
They are the agency that's following the definition of agency.
I think that sort of says.
Oh, sorry.
No, go ahead. I just wondered if you had thought about that before you filed.
Mr. Allen, this whole area of the law, when it comes to how do you handle appeals of the BZA, and frankly, what is the role of the BZA, and are there more than one party on the city side of the ledger or not? It's frankly more complicated than any of us would like for it to be. Those of us in local government law, as well as in other practices that hit upon it, have wrestled with this whole issue for a long time. The bottom line is that on the city side of the ledger, there is but one client, and that is the city. And the city, as a court, because it is a Virginia municipal corporation, and it is a legally recognized entity. And so under the law, it is that entity that represents the city. And so in that sense, the city really is never suing itself, because all of its functions, all of its departments, all of its boards, all of its commissions are part of the city. Then, of course, you very quickly devolve into questions of what happens when one commission takes a slightly different view from another commission or from city council. And so you get into that whole issue of who speaks, what voice speaks for the city. And it can be a fairly complicated analysis. But at the end of the day, the city is, the voice of the city is expressed through the elected representatives, that is the city council. They are the one official legally recognized voice for the city. So that their voice then flows through the city manager, his senior staff, and the city attorney. So,
but wouldn't you agree that the city council would not be one of the parties that could apply to?
Yeah, I would say in our charter provision,
maybe it falls under corporate.
It's in the office of department board or agency
right.
of the city.
Right.
So any officer department board or agency.
So like maybe that's why you put Farrell Hamer as a part. Because she's the officer.
Well, because she is the department head where the decision is being made. That's why she included it. But the city council can appeal.
They are the agency that's following the definition of agency.
I think that sort of said.
Yeah,
so now we're a little bit on charted waters with respect to that.
If I can respond to that, you're right. I don't want to get too much into a law school exercise on this one. Frankly, city attorneys often present a very unique example of legal representation from a lawyer's perspective, because we represent such a large and diverse client that has the potential to speak with so many different voices. It often causes analytically a lot of questions to arise. But in this case, what happens is under Charter 11.02, I do represent the entire city, specifically by the terms and definitions of 11.02. I represent the city council, city manager, all departments, all boards, all commissions. In this particular case, I will give you sort of the legal analytical approach to this, and it may not represent a lot of common sense for a lot of folks, but I will give you at least that analytical approach to this. The interests of the city are, on this side, the ones that are sort of, if you would, represented by what one would really think of as being the planning director's sort of voice at this point. Why that is not different, why that is not a conflict with the Board of Zoning Appeals is because in this particular instance, the Board of Zoning Appeals is really sitting as a judge. You're in a quasi-judicial capacity. And so think about it this way, Mr. Allen. If I sued you in circuit court before Judge Dawkins, you get a judgment against me, and I don't like the judgment, and I wish to appeal it to the Virginia Supreme Court. I will have a lawyer when we go to the Supreme Court. You will have a lawyer when you go to the Supreme Court. But Judge Dawkins does not, because he was the judge in the case. Similarly here, the BZA sat as a judge. You rendered a decision, and what is being appealed is really a matter for the lawyers of the landowners and the city to advocate before each other, and your record gets sent up to the circuit court to be reviewed. And so just like Judge Dawkins' record would be sent to the Supreme Court, and they would make their decisions based upon what Judge Dawkins is in the official record of Judge Dawkins, similar here. So I continue to represent the city because, in this instance, the BZA doesn't really have, in common parlance, no dog in that fight.
On behalf of the board, even though the board would be a direct an adversarial posture to that. Not to say that we would file that, but hypothetically speaking, the BZA could submit additional materials with its return.
This is where, again, you get between what applies the charter and the code. And when you read the our charter, it's clear that the only role that the BZA has is to submit its record. Once you submit your record, you are out of it, period.
So, Max, where does that say that in the city charter?
Again, Mr. Goodell, that's something that you've got to, I probably spend the next 5 hours going through it and pulling all the pieces together. But the analysis is simply that the BZA's role is to submit its record.
But it doesn't say that specifically in the charter.
I don't see that. That's an appeal. It's an appeal to the circuit court on the record. And so there is, so the BZA is required to provide the record to the circuit court, and there's no, the BZA, the charter doesn't give any authorization, neither does the state code for the BZA to give anything other than the record.
Well, that's not accurate. I mean, Ms. Lewis just told you that the Virginia code explicitly.
And that provision we believe does not apply to the city.
So you are saying the city can pick and choose what it wants, the charter versus the Virginia code?
No, again, and you know, I will tell you that that is the criticism that we always hear whenever there's an issue of statutory construction about the charter and the code. And that's, frankly, it's not us cherry picking. It is simply a matter of statutory construction.
Well, maybe we should seek an opinion from the state attorney general to weigh in on this issue, because I mean, this does seem like cherry picking to me.
You just said that, you know, part of section 2314 does apply with respect to the captioning, but now you're saying other additional sections of this of the code don't apply. I just don't see how the two can be.
And I understand that you don't see that, and there are a whole lot of folks that don't see that as well. I asked Mr. Wilbur, who is also on my team.
If I may weigh in on the question, but the statute provides the answer to that, because the statute says you shall participate, but it doesn't put a period there. It says you shall participate to the extent required by the section. And so then you look at the section and look at and determine what your obligations are in the section, and the only obligation of the section is to certify the record. And then the statute makes even more clear what that record shall be. It's a paper submitted to you, it's a transcript, which is the oral submission to you, and any subsequent findings of fact that you've done. So that puts the punctuation on your obligation, which is to certify and transmit the record that's specified here. You're correct. This is unusual in civil procedure practice, because typically when you're a respondent, you're a party and you litigate a case. But here you are a respondent for only the specific purpose outlined in the statute and no other. And to follow up on what Mr. Goodell said, the General Assembly may want to make absolutely clear that you're not a party. You know, to go back to the question, Chairman, that you asked at the very beginning about the style of it, the style of the case in the first instance is correct. The style of the case is not incorrect in the sense that your respondent and typically respondents are listed in the caption. But in response to the comments that were made and some of the public concern about at least the appearance of diversity, or that this was an action against the board, or conformance with 2014. And conformance, but this is where, as Mr. Banks said, there's a gap between the charter, which has co-equal status with the code and doesn't require that, and the code. And what the city determined to do is to make it absolutely clear, both changing the caption and then changing paragraph 3 of that petition to add in the specific purpose for which the BZA is named. Well, it was a helpful discussion that occurred previously, because it frankly identified some of the confusion that's created with a caption and a procedure that's probably, you know, 75 years old. But in this case, it's particularly sensitive, and those sensitivities came to the forefront, and the city determined to make the change to alleviate that.
Let me ask you
some answers to stay focused on your question. In terms of how it occurred in the past, I'm not familiar with the appeal you're talking about. I assume the appeal you're talking about is by a landowner adverse to the city. The landowner's attorney captions that, names the parties, and it sounds like an instance you talked about, misnamed the BZA as a party, but they should not have been.
But the point, the difference in that case is that the city's interests were aligned with the Board's appeals, so there wasn't really, it didn't seem like there was any conflict. But for the city attorney to be representing both, that's why every pleading starts out and comes now the city, you know, the city council and the Board of Zoning Appeals by council.
Understood. There's no adversity between your interests, because when you look at the two interests, and that's what the starting point, the city's interest is in obtaining the reversal, sustaining the director's decision. That's not the BZA's interest. The BZA's interest is established by the statute. And the statute says the BZA has an obligation to do certain things. And on that issue, there's no adversity. To the extent the BZA wanted to consult counsel, there's no adversity between your obligation or your desire, I'll say, to consult counsel on what is the record and when do we transmit it, which is all that's required.
We felt naked with respect to this.
I understand. And I think it's fair. The BZA can ask those questions of the city attorney because there's no adversity between the tendering of an answer on what's the record, when does it have to be provided, and the city's interest, which is on the substantive issue.
So when it comes time for us to file the record, is the city attorney's office comfortable filing that record and entering an appearance on behalf of the Board of Zoning Appeals?
Well, they would file the record. They would not, in that case, the BZA, I believe, was a party. But they would not, I believe, I'm sort of speaking ahead where Jim is on this, but they would not enter an appearance because you only enter an appearance for a party. By statute, they're not a party. By caption, they're not a party. In that case, whatever that case is, the one procedural way to fix that would have been to move to dismiss or strike the BZA because they're not a proper party under the statute. That didn't happen. I can't speak to why. But this case needs to be done correctly, and the BZA is not a party. The BZA should not enter an appearance, and the record should be transmitted. And the statute, I believe, requires a certification from the BZA. Staff would compile it. It would be submitted to the circuit court, and that would be the end of the analysis. But there's no adversity to the extent the BZA has a question on when do we tender it, or what do the record include. There's no adversity between the provision of that advice and the city's position, which is on the substantive issue.
And to answer your question, Mr. Allen, we feel comfortable with that, because what would happen is staff would prepare the record, and we would have a transmittal letter saying, here's the record on behalf of the BZA.
By the city attorney.
Yes, sir. Because again, as counsel has indicated, there is no adversity. There's no...
I get completely the fact that this isn't the city council versus the Board of Zoning Appeals. Even if that legal advice was to tell us that we didn't need a lawyer. Because, you know, we keep hearing that, well, you don't need a lawyer, but we're hearing that from one of the participants in the case. Do you understand why that makes people uncomfortable?
I do. I ask you, Mr. Yeah,
and I understand. You know, ultimately, that's what I'm trying to do, and I think we're trying to answer the question, but not advocate. And I don't want to walk that line because I don't want to advocate that you don't get a lawyer. I'd sort of answer the legal question of why legally it's not required or appropriate. But ultimately, I'd say it's a city council issue. And I don't think the city attorney's office is advocating one way or the other. But in answering the question about whether is it required, it's not required, are you a person that with whom an attorney-client relationship separate from the city can exist, I'd suggest not. There are some legal issues like that that are happy to answer. But ultimately, you've raised a concern that exists, at least in your mind, and maybe some of the other members, and that's something that certainly can be raised to the city council. And I think ultimately they make the decision on that.
In my simple mind, it was a little bit like a little old lady who gets a general district court warrant for death from a collections agency and then calls the lawyer who filed it and says, oh, don't worry, you don't need a lawyer. You understand? That's how it felt.
Sure. And again, the only thing that I could add is really just to sort of repeat what Mr. Wolpin has already said, and that is that there really is no adversity between this city and the BZA in this matter. The BZA is seen as, in effect, a judge, and your responsibility is merely an administrative one. And my advising you on that administrative function and filing that administrative function, transmitting that administrative function for you to the court presents no adversity, presents no conflict of interest. And therefore, yes, I do that because it's just an administrative function.
Because that's the
just an administrative, and I grant you, Mr. Allen, that this is an unusual circumstance, but that's the applicable analysis. And I want to make sure that I really clarify my role in this whole thing, and Mr. Wilburn alluded to. My role really was to analyze this from the city manager's perspective and to recommend to him what the law requires and what it does not require. And my analysis is contained in that memorandum that you saw from me to him. And essentially that I went through what you saw there. That is that the BZA is not a separate legal entity, it is not a separate party, it is not adverse to the city. For those reasons, there is not a requirement to provide legal counsel. I referred that to the city manager. Based upon that, city manager made the decision that he did not wish to incur the additional expense, whatever that expense may have been, great or large, to retain additional counsel. And so that's simply how it played out.
All that the BZA had to do was to transmit the administrative record to the court. I don't understand why the Virginia General Assembly wouldn't use those exact words in 15.2-2314 when they amended it in 2010. The BZA shall transmit the administrative record. That would be clear, but it's, again, has this sentence, return shall concisely set forth such other facts as may be pertinent and material to show the grounds of the decision appealed to and shall be verified. And where that gets important to me is because, as I'm sure you know, the findings of fact and conclusions of law that we approved at the last hearing was one half page long. The petition for appeal, the amended petition for appeal, is 10 pages long, with assertions about the BZA did this, BZA didn't recognize the absurdity of applying the ownership requirement. And what I'm concerned is, if we just transmit the administrative record, and the judge looks at these findings of fact and conclusions of law, the party for the appellants would say, well, there's a huge disconnect between what the city attorneys filed through McGuire Woods, what the BZA's findings of fact and conclusions of law were, and we need BZA to be witnesses to help us resolve this. Whereas if we submitted a concise statement of fact as to what our rationale was for coming up with our conclusion, we'd be able to avoid the potential position of potentially being deposed or called fact witnesses at a trial. I mean, that's my primary concern. I think that's a concern of some other board members, is that given this distance, if we just transmit the administrative record, either the appellants or the judge will say, no, we need BZA to clarify things for us. How do you respond to that?
I think a complete reading of that paragraph, though, is the response. It's not the half-page findings of fact, conclusions of law that you held up. Read in its entirety, it's the submissions. And recall, there were substantial submissions submitted by both parties to this. It's the oral submissions. The hearing, as I remember, was more than 4 hours in terms of discussion from the community, discussion by the board prior to the vote. So the board obviously had an opportunity to submit additional findings of fact, and you've done that. But the record is not simply that. The record is the collection of all of that information on which the decision was based.
Mr.
Rieger,
that gets back to the original point I made, that what the BCA chose to submit. Because I think under 2314, you can, if we so desire.
Like this, the Board of Zoning Appeals basically proceeds unrepresented because it's the position of the city attorney's office and it doesn't need counsel. Am I correct?
No. As to procedural matters and issues, I am still your attorney. Yes, so in that sense, no. If you've got administrative procedural questions, I am, by charter, your lawyer.
Let me just add to that. I think where you might have an issue, theoretically, I'm trying to to pick up on some of the theories and outliers in the discussion, is if there was a point of adversity, then, you know, it seems to me then there might be a situation where there would be a need for an independent attorney. For example, if there was an argument that the BZA was not responding to a FOIA request, and that a board member in particular was refusing to produce material. City attorney's office has, the city has one obligation, and it could be adverse to that particular board member. There may be other examples where, I can't think of off the top of my head, where the board member is doing something that is arguably outside the scope of his or her function, and there could be adversity. In the circumstance we have here, and I won't repeat all that I've said, there's no adversity. If we could define some adversity, some actual adversity, then there may be a need to have independent counsel.
I think, again, what came up in my mind is not necessarily that we need a representation.
The conclusion that they come to. Under the above analysis, the committee concludes that regardless of whether the BZA is a former or current client, the county attorney has a conflict of interest in filing this petition against the BZA. Indicative of the nature of that conflict is that the BZA would come to request representation in the lawsuit. It was he who evaluated their legal need and determined that, in his view, the BZA needs no legal counsel. The mere provision of that legal advice, which is legal advice, triggered a conflict of interest for this attorney, as his client, Board of Supervisors, would seem to have an interest in whether or not a party it is suing has counsel in the matter.
What's the date of that LEO?
November 14th, 2003.
I mean, I don't know. I'll look at the LEO. I'll make a note of that. But the LEO, a couple of initial reactions. One predates the non-party statute, previously other parties. There's LEO 1836, which touches upon the issue. There are a lot of LEOs. The LEOs, what's important about those is they do provide guidance on conflict issues, as all the attorneys know. They are bar reactions to specific fact situations that are presented, hypothetical situations. So I'm happy to look at that issue. I want to be clear, I'm not making, and Mr. Banks is not making a decision advising you that you can't have an attorney on this. Ultimately, it's in the city manager or city council will do that. Mr. Banks was asked to do the analysis on whether the facts presented in this case there was adversity that would impair his professional and independent judgment. And what the bar has said, and at least the LEO that I'm familiar with, is that when the separate counsel is not needed, unless there is I'll just read the portion of it. The city attorney may continue to represent constituents of which you are alone, even when they disagree on legal or policy issues, unless the conflict materially limits the city attorney's representation of the city's interest or interferes with the city's attorney's exercise of independent professional judgment. So I will look at the LEO. Mr. Banks will provide advice to Mr. Banks on the LEO, and he'll provide advice to the city. Where this turns on an ethical issue is there something about diversity between the constituent and the locality that would impair the independent judgment of the city attorney's office such that they have to have separate counsel? And it strikes me that the issue that has to be considered here in terms of your obligations are the administrative record to be provided. I don't believe that presents a conflict. And I'd say the staff probably, I don't know how many BZA appeals have taken place, but staff has probably prepared records for you lots and lots of times. And the process should be no different in this case in terms of compiling the record than in every other case that you've done. That's what makes it administrative in nature. Because the city is seeking reversal of your decision, doesn't change the administrative function on how to compile a record. Staff has done that lots of times and should do the exact same thing in this case.
And the city attorney's office will file on our behalf.
Simply file it. I don't know if that's from the city attorney's office or someone else.
So will there be one of the legal evidence?
It is not my role. It's not my role in this case or in any other to speak about policy issues. I simply provide the legal, my best legal analysis and advice. And I am the very first to tell you that my legal analysis does in no way preclude additional considerations, nor is it or should it be the final word on a policy decision. There is, first of all, financial decision that's beyond me, and on an operational day-to-day basis, the city manager makes those decisions. There is a policy decisions that are above and beyond the manager's day-to-day operational decisions, and those are in the hands of city council. And so my legal analysis and opinion does not speak to either one of those. It is just that, legal analysis.
Since you should do whatever you want, it's nothing.
Us as a body reviewing and certifying it, as the fact that we're not trial lawyers, there may be a couple attorneys here that maybe feel more.
I don't know why.
And Mr. Lancy,
what would it mean for us to certify it?
And Mr. Lancy,
I would seek somebody else who has really familiarity with what that means, doing that rather than not doing it.
I will tell you. What I probably tell my staff almost every day on matters that we see. The biggest problem that we have as a city or as trial lawyers is when you try to justify what you did differently and why you did it differently. So back to Mr. Wilburn's point, I would say that you would compile the record and transmit the record in exactly the fashion the way it has always been done. And the main reason for that is because the court has never told staff, city attorney's office, or the BZA that a record that has been transmitted in that fashion was false.
Let me add one other point to this. There's sort of a practical element to this, and I don't put my friend, Mr. Chan, on the spot at all, and I'm not gonna do that, but the record seems to me, I've said a few times what it is, and what it's always been, which is this written submission, transcript, and the findings of fact. I have a friendly relationship with Landowners Council and have asked him, and we've continued to ask, was there something else? That sort of anticipating this issue, is there something that you think should be in the record that's not? And if there is, let us know. We're happy to figure that out. Because I don't want to put one on the spot, I really don't, but I'd have the same question. We hope to talk the last few days, next week, or the week after, which is, this is the record that's always going up in every case. It's no different. But if there's something you think that's wrong with that, or is different, or should be different, guys, let us know what you think should be in there. And I don't think there's anything that the landowner side believes should be in the record that's not always in the records I described. The transcript, the written submissions, and the findings of fact. If there is, you'll be able to hear about it and then discuss it, and maybe there's an issue that becomes apparent. But I suspect that's not the case.
I think it would go a long way towards frustrations and fears if you folks would file the record. We've had an opportunity to both look at it and jointly conclude that it's okay.
We're happy to do that, and we've offered to do that.
And once again, I don't want to get 6 months into this case and then have somebody say, well, the Board of Zoning Appeals did do its job because they let the staff do it, and even though that was always the way they did it, but this time they let the lawyer for the petitioner sign off on it.
See, the sort of two sides of this. One is, I really think you ought to do what you always do as administrative, and that's what should occur. But I had, recognizing that this is a significant public issue, reached out to Mr. Shannon and said to try and resolve any concern about what the record should be. If there's something else you think, let us know. But that's where you have to walk on, because the city attorney's office should not influence what staff does. But try and address this potential concern. That's, I think, the obvious answer. What a work session. If there's something other than the transcript, the submissions, the findings of fact, which are what are always submitted, which the code requires, then we should surface that issue. But otherwise, staff ought to do whatever they always do. And you ought to do whatever you always do. But going back to the policy issue, I don't know if there's somebody had raised potentially asking the city council again to reconsider the issue for any number of policy reasons, but I think that's perfectly, sort of personal view, perfectly fine thing to do. Whether council should be supplied, you know, or funded. But the city attorney's office not advising you. I think you're trying to answer the questions that were posed by the city manager. There may be policy, there may be public relations or other issues that mitigate in favor of it.
What I would add to that is that in this instance, you are different from any other, you are no different from any other board or commission of the city. You are, and I believe it's the policy of city council, you are always open to communicate your concerns and your issues directly to city council about any matter. And that there's absolutely nothing that I'm aware of in this case that would change that relationship.
I just
just think for very normal amount, this is possible.
Whatever issue, far be it for me to tell you that you can't do that.
But the other point is, again, I was sort of saying publicly, since I've said it privately, if there's, this is something that shouldn't be an issue, there shouldn't be lack of cooperation with the record is, and welcome the landowners to tell us what, if they think something should be different or different in the record, tell us, we worked out service issues.
We worked out the findings of fact.
Worked out the findings. This is an administrative thing that should be simple, which is if they think there's something that I've said about what the record statutory issue contains, just tell us what it is. We can examine it right here publicly and move from there, but I don't think there's a disagreement. I've not heard of one.
Yeah. Part of the issue is there is a lot of ethical concerns, and if you're represented by counsel, I'm not supposed to talk to you, but if you are represented, if it gives me permission, then I can speak with you.
We're not a party.
But you're represented by counsel.
I said I wasn't, Mr. Shannon, but
that is part of the concern, and my concern is, I think, what the BZA is putting out here is normally, if staff has a question, who would they ask? If they're going to ask the city attorney, finance administrator, but they're also signed the pleading, they're on the other side. And typically, when you're on the same side, you guys haven't had that problem, but now...
You're on us side.
You're on a side, but you're in it. And so to me, I think that what I don't know is the conversations that have been going back and forth, and the advising does create a problem for us. In terms of agreeing on what the record is or agreeing on findings of fact, that's one thing. But if there's a question that you guys have and you go ask the city attorney's office, if that could hurt my clients, well, I feel uncomfortable with that. If you had a independent counsel who wasn't part of it, I think the appearance as well as the advice would be different. In terms of agreeing on the record, that's one thing. But if staff has never gone to the city attorney's office, never asked them a question about the record, what should they do? All right, to me, I don't know, maybe the staff has never gone to the city attorney's office and said, what should we do in this situation? Or do we include this or do we not include this? And if that question is being asked, then I would have an issue with that. I mean, regardless of the other provisions that talk about whether or not there's going to be additional information, but in terms of agreeing on a record, I'm sure that we can agree on a record, but again, I would want to speak with my clients first as well as Michael Ferry's not here.
Mr. Chairman, if I could, from my perspective,